We just talked for 40 minutes and said that it's not going to do that. So we at Lois is different than the traditional academic organization. I was talking with Steve earlier. Almost everything we do have real world partners. I mentioned it earlier. We develop robust systems. So we do more than proof of concept. We do proof of concept sometimes, but usually we do more than proof of concept. Here is an example. It just occurs to me. This is a research system, and there is a commercial version of this being developed as we speak. And it's being incubated right in here. This system, for example, Yolanda, it helps you. This system is in real use. This is actually collecting data for Yolanda that is being given to people for doing micro tasking, or it's called social tasking, whereby then they identify from social media data important things related to handling management of the typhoon Yolanda crisis related things, right? So Philippines is battered by that, and this thing understand this variety of things in real time. So India cycle, in India elections, for example. So we do analysis of election. We did Hurricane Sandy here. In fact, there is a Hurricane Sandy here. There were a lot of analysis related. 5 million tweets in the first week were analyzed to understand what is happening here. And this does pretty comprehensive analysis. Social, spatio-temporal, thematic, people, content, network, sentiment, emotion, intent analysis of social media, driven by a very robust background knowledge. For example, when we do so this is, by the way, as I said, used by micromappers of UNOCHA relief effort. And for example, when we do India election, let's say, then the system has the knowledge of all the 500 plus constituencies in India and various political entities and all kinds of stuff. So it's not just statistical analysis of machine learning or NLP or sentiment analysis of textual data. It's not more going on in the background on what happens. But coming back to this thing, so we have a whole bunch of systems and demos and such like the ones I gave. What I'm going to do is to pick out, I think, two or three of them and give you a sampling, again, to show you the maturity of the technology that is out there and kind of possible things that we may borrow from for the work that we hope to do in this general area or what we for some of you. So one tool is Kilo, a semantic annotation tool. It helps, it's an integrated set of tools to annotate unstructured resources. Now it uses NCBO ontologies. So NCBO stands for National Center for Biomedical Ontologies. And if you go to bioportal.org, you will see well over 300 ontologies. And I'm going to, I have some wrapping of slides on that later on. So whatever, and so there is an API to that ontology. Imagine that depending upon resources we invest in this area, 3-5 years down the road, they have a few ontologies out there, and that you be able to connect to that using an API on the fly to do your data annotations and various other things that you can do with annotations, right? So that way here, there's a browser plugin that would allow you to annotate any web document. So you'll pull up a document on the web in this plugin, and then you have annotated our backend. For example, it supports Facet and such. So here, you can see there is a document that is picked up And here you can see through the interface there is access to the ontology. And with these, you can see things can be annotated here. So human is validating the rotation, system is suggesting the rotations. Right? And those annotations, and now your choice of ontologies. You can have something based on you know, one group versus you know, another group versus one domain versus another group. Suppose you want to delete biomaterials, then you pick up that ontology to use rather than something else. So you have choices. And then those annotations get indexed, and then they make the document searchable.
Does the indexing occur relative to the ontology, or how are the documents indexed?
So basically, you know, annotation is a tag and the value, and these things are you know, indexed both so that you can search by them. Right? When you're going to do search, which is the next thing, you're typically going to in the facet, which is a property or attribute or whatever you call it. You're going to say for this property, when there is a match like this, give me the document. And so that is what this thing would be indexed in there, and do that in a rapid manner. So here you can do faceted search. So this shows you a document, you know, it happens to have image for learning and there's a lung cancer, and there's ontology in BioPortal about lung cancer, and it helps you identify this term, and you are annotating it. And then you have search. So you put in that, and the system will return you all the documents. So it's a relatively very simple tool, and there's a demo for that. I'm going to not give you this demo because I have some other more interesting ones to come. Let me next talk to you about Schooner. It's very interesting tool. This was supported by the domain by the AFRL, Human Effectiveness Domain Directive. They have biologists, and they are searching for materials on biochemical and toxin and things of that nature. And they would do typically go to PubMed and do a search, keyword search, a lot of documents. And so the quality of search result, keyword search result, is not something that really helps them. So the idea was that we created a knowledge base in that domain, and then we created this tool. Let's see what happens. So what we do is we carve out a focus domain, because the domain that was chosen was human performance and cognition. Give us any domain like that. And then our sponsor gave us a bunch of keywords. Then we have a tool called Doozer that will go and mine Wikipedia and find all the semi-structured data in Wikipedia related to those keywords, you know, crawling to all the associated content. And then it will get all of this together and automatically create a domain model. Then we would take that domain model, use it as a trellis, and put individual knowledge-based facts extracted from biomedical literature in that specific domain. So here, domain-specific keywords, base hierarchy from Wikipedia, and then a couple of techniques around, you know, one is you know, basic NLP engine, Stanford parser, extended peoples, and other is rule-based extraction of biomedical literature called biomedical knowledge repository, millions of facts. enhance the high-level model that was created using Wikipedia, and then we got what you see here is what I call enriched knowledge base or final knowledge base. So we ended up creating 2 million entities and 3 million relationships. And that's a respectable size of knowledge in any domain. Can I claim that this knowledge base is complete? No. I can't tell you exactly what the recall is. But it's pretty substantial. And to the extent that there is a concept of interest, our system will do some interesting things with it. So I'll talk to you about that. This is system architecture. There's a lot of stuff going on there. I won't, you know, typical things in NLP and things of that nature and knowledge-based systems. I won't go into that in detail. But let's look at the demo. Now, I'm just going to jump to some few interesting parts. Now, this tool is also usable by a community of people. I'll explain how. But what happened is that the knowledge base we created of 2 million concepts and 3 million relationships was used to index entire PubMed set of abstracts, so about 18 to 20 million abstracts were all processed. We recently ran more sophisticated, you know, another one where we again indexed the entire PubMed abstract corpus with the BKR, new version of BKR. We have a long-term relation with National Library of Medicine. So in fact, last summer itself, 3 students did internship at NLM. So what so all those entities get spotted. And remember that the knowledge base is all those relationships also that have been extracted from from the corpus, right? So now for any document, any search we do, see what happens. So there are multiple abstracts, and the terms that are the search term is highlighted here, but all the other things in the ontology are also highlighted. Concepts. It activates, for example, this thing. You can. Thank you. So we are interested in things where VSP is related for iron transplant, regular iron transplant rather. Right? So it's not exactly that thing, this text, but this is then what is called as triple. Vasoactive intestinal peptide regulates iron transplant. These triple was extracted from this text and is matched with the ontology, which we browse in the ontology, vasoactive intestinal peptide regulates iron transplant. And that any sentences where this concept is expressed will be identified. So then this tool allows you to do a lot of other things. You can select the abstracts, put in one, things and collect all the relevant material and then do deeper analysis of this thing. When you follow this path, it's called trailblazing. This was a concept that was defined or was first talked about in 1945 by Vannevar Bush. Very well known scientist, and he wrote a very interesting article called As We May Think, where he talked about memex, his conception of how machines can mimic brain activity, and he talked about trailblazing, saying that how does human mind thinks? It latches onto the concept and then goes to another concept in context. For example, it's very likely that if you think about noesis in the relation to noesis, you might think about me or TK or somebody that you meet here. That context is very relevant, or vice versa. Right? That you may recognize that I'm associated with noesis, and that is how you may do the things. You just don't jump arbitrarily. There is usually this kind of connections. Right? And so this thing allows that very human-centric process of trailblazing supported by machine. In human brain, we have a lot of knowledge, we have a lot of experience, and we are going to do our trailblazing based on the concepts we have in our knowledge base. The same thing is happening here. Machine is doing from one concept to another concept, latching onto that, giving you all the options of the concepts. Human is guiding that because, of course, computer does not have free will like human does. And so we will guide, saying, I'm interested in this, I'm interested in this. But the baseline is given by the machine. The machine understands that baseline. Right? Then all this trailblazing can be stored. So expert scientists can do trailblazing, store it, and now you can use that as a training for the people. Or you can find multiple trails on the things you come about and say, oh, looks like there's a potential of abuse of this biotoxin. And you can create, do the research along that line. The same thing you can think about potentially in material science. Like, I know this material has this property under this condition leads to this thing. And it's possible that you might find a material in the same class, not exactly the same material, and you want to investigate the same thing for that one. So, what you may know about one thing, you may want to try out or something related, say, is there any literature out there or any data element out there that allows me to investigate these more complex connections similar to the one that I have known for something else, right? So, this is an example process you may pursue in knowledge discovery, right? Or investigations of some kind. There are other, this is a fairly robust tool, so there are other practical things about sharing and login and password and all kinds of stuff that you can do here. Okay. So So the next one, and Steve, you'll be interested in this one. We are talking about PDOS, prescription drug abuse, online surveillance and epidemiology. So it so happened that about 3 years ago, I've been interacting with CITAR, the DF Center for Drug Abuse and that kind of stuff, intervention. They are epidemiologists and they study drug abuse basically. They have, they bring in people and interview them, the people who are doing, drug abuse and interview them and come up with saying how people are using drug abuse. But I saw a discussion of this kind that is freely volunteered by actual drug abusers on social media in web forums. So we made a proposal to NIH. It interestingly got funded the same week that the White House announced the initiative for prescription drug abuse, managing prescription drug abuse epidemic in US. So there are a lot of people, this is statistics, 100 people die every day from drug overdose. I think that's been increasing. 36,000 drug overdose, deaths since 2008 and so on and so forth. And there were 14,800 prescription painkillers in 2008, right? So there's a lot of data on that line. So we developed this system called PDOS, and here, you have web forums, you have web crawlers, we can either get the book from them or we can crawl them. You have data cleaning, the data is very, very massive. People who are doing drug abuse don't write full text, they don't have capitalization, they don't have periods, and they go from one thought to another thoughts, it's very hard. We put that in the informal text database, then we have drug abuse ontology. This ontology, it was not done automatically. This was primarily done manually with some tools to make its development faster. So in fact, I'm saying all this because there's no one way to develop ontology. There are many things that we really have to look at each of those situations differently. In the previous one, I tried to convey to you that a lot of this ontology population can be done automatically. The schema was the manual, or some manual. But very interestingly, in this drug abuse ontology, for example, you know all the synonyms of a particular drug. And here is a very telling example. For every one occurrence of drug buprenorphine, there were 33 occurrences of SLAD in the text that we had. So now think about it. Either you will have to create classifiers using machine learning for each of those things, or you will have to do something like what we are doing. Ours is far more scalable and cost-effective technique compared to what traditional machine learning technique would require if you want to take that out. And I can give you many examples of this sort. Then we have information extraction. You extract entity, relationship, people, sentiments. I'll show you this. All that goes into PeopleStore RDA database, and then we have the front-end tool. I'll show you what the tool does. Let us see what the kind of processing this system does. And I think this is very interesting, and is as far as I can tell, it's one of the most sophisticated processing of text that I've seen of this kind. So you can see Suboxone and Bupe. This is entity extraction, but note that the system has identified all these entities and system understands that Bupe is a super, Suboxone is a brand name and a subtype of buprenorphine. So that knowledge and this is Bupe and such comes from the system. Phenobarbital is another drug and that is identified, and it's not just the drug that is identified. So you can see here, Bupe is a slang term, or Bupe is a slang term of buprenorphine, syndrome of buprenorphine. system understand these relationships, right? Then you have this ontology, not a huge ontology, but still pretty interesting ontology with, and there were, and for every one occurrence of loperamide, we found 24 occurrences of slants. And now you see there's a lot more of annotation, annotations. So there is dosage. For example, 2MG. You can see that is annotated. Pronouns are annotated. Intervals, 24 hours after. Route of administration, injected. Drug is injected. Relationships, feel pretty damn good. Sentiments, bad day, right? So you can see a variety of things that can be accepted. And you know, your sentiments are positive and negative sentiments. And this is the more sophisticated part of it, which is to accept these triples. So I have Suboxone injection causes cephalalgia. I can spell that. But the point here is that that is Bupe maps to that, and headache is this other thing match, right? So these are not exact string matches, but how is this possible? This is possible through semantics. This is possible through ontology. I'll be very happy to to debate any other alternative techniques that can do this effectively well, which I mean NLP alone, machine learning alone, right? And now, when you identify that, you can code this, meaning the human epidemiologist is interested in this. And so for the other people, you can automatically code this like that. Which means that what will be done by human manually can be substantially done automatically through this process. Now, so what does this involve? Is a series of techniques, your ontology, that helps in people, entity and people extraction, like these. You have lexicals for emotion, intensity, pronouns, and sentiment. You have lexicography of the form, drug form, route of administration, and side effect. And these are some of these side effects and things of that nature, route of administration. And your rule is grammar, dosage, frequency, interval. And this kind of shows role of semantic web and ontologies compared to machine learning, NLP, and IR techniques, and how this one either complements or enhances those traditional, well-known, well-used techniques. Okay? So, for entity extraction, there are benefits that semantic web has, triple extraction it has, and so on. Okay, let's look at the demo. This is a very interesting demo, but I think in terms of time, what happens is in scenario, you are starting with a term, and then you are building a complex template or pattern.
Consider itself.
video editing. Basically what happens here is, it's very interesting.
Content on prescription and other drug abuse practices are freely reported by Web4 participants. Then to complete our specification of dosage, we will select the unit milligram from the list.
So
finally,
so the person builds actually pretty complicated query saying that show me the post about somebody abusing this drug with more than 25 milligrams per day through the method of injection or something like that. So you are reading a fairly complicated query that may involve units of something. Now I think many material science domain you may have to deal with the values, right? Not just the text elements. So you have to, you can bring in those kind of stuff. In fact, I also believe that we might have to do some level of mathematical modeling in our ontology and some level of having arithmetic and values and those kind of stuff. Those can all be done. So let me see if I can just skip them. What happens here is that this system will get you all the results. It will find you the matches.
Number five.
Something about this browser, I think, the video will go, but I think should have tested on that. But I think you basically get an idea that fairly, but not only that, this tool gives you a trend analysis. So it draws the, just such complicated things as show me the abuse of this drug over the period of time done through this method. So for example, OxyContin was reformulated into a form that when you crush it, it becomes gooey. So it does not, it's not easily digestible, so people cannot get high through using that after reformulation. So then it can help you study, well, when, show me OxyContin over the period, use of, over the period of this time, and show me other drug whose, so OxyContin uses went down, but other drugs, people started using other things. And so it will help you understand what are the other preferred methods for the people who are getting off OxyContin and they're trying out something else. So they can do all kinds of analysis of that kind from this particular thing. We are working towards a very large operational system. If it is funded as a UO1 mechanism, that would allow toxicologists in the emergency rooms to have direct access to the patterns of drug abuse of the new drugs as they through geolocations and many other things of that nature. Okay, I think we should wrap up.